Just a second. Just wanted to turn that off. All right. Sorry. So I'm fairly new to this public speaking thing, and I'm still trying to figure out what makes a good presentation. But one thing that I realize is that the best way to give a good presentation is to really set low expectations before you start. So you can knock something over or start fiddling with your cable, or which is my favorite, is to give reviews from the previous times you gave the talk. So this is a review for my wife. And she said the second half is not as boring as the first. So thank you. Another one I got from the last time I gave this talk was the material was out of date, and even I noticed stuff, and I didn't learn anything, which kind of hurt a little bit. But my initial reaction was like, well, A, this person is an idiot, or B, we should hire this person because they're a genius. But after I thought about it for a while, I actually realized that it might have been like a print designer, someone who's used to all the things that you take for granted on print, and you can't do on the web. I mean, it's not that long ago that we only had Arial or Times New Roman as web safe fonts. And now we can use pretty much any font. We can use Straight Sans, Quixo, whatever. And that's basically all due to this, the font face declaration. You can define it and then use it, and you point it to a file on your server, and that's it. And I'd like to point out that the font family is actually a label. It doesn't mean anything to the browser. So you can give it a name, like Helvetica Neue, and then point it to Comic Sans, and the browser will just render it like that. And that works. You might not be that popular with your teammates if you do that, but it works. What you usually see when you look at the font-based decoration is all of this, which is all the font formats. Sorry, this is really bothering me. Yeah, that's better. There are six web font formats. You have TrueType, you have OpenType, SVG, EOT, WAF, and WAF2, or as I like to call them, WOOF and WOOF WOOF. You're probably familiar with TTF and OTF, and I'm not going to really talk about it. I'd like to talk a little bit about SVG fonts. I hate SVG fonts. Sorry. Yeah. SVG fonts are not really fonts. They're just SVG files with outlines in them. You don't get any of the features in an SVG font that you have in an other font formats, like OpenType features. You don't have kerning. You don't have anything. So my recommendation is just to not use them. Just forget about them. They don't exist. So what are all these other formats then? EOT, WAF, and WAF2? Well, they're basically what we call container formats, which is that they are wrappers around the other two formats, either TrueType or OTF files. And they're usually compressed. One thing to note is that the most popular generator for EOT files doesn't compress EOT files. They can be compressed, but they're usually not. So if you're serving EOT files, you should check whether they're compressed or not. And if they're not, then you should serve them with a gzip compression, which is usually not done. Actually discovered on Typekit that we didn't do that, so I fixed that like last week, which is like crazy. Yeah, we should know this stuff. So WAF is pretty much gzipped as well. Actually, I had this discussion with Tim last week as well, and I pointed out you can, instead of using the standard compression algorithm in WAF, you can use Subflea, which is like a new algorithm by Google, and it generates compatible output to gzip. So it compresses better. You get like 5 to 8% better compression on your web fonts. And it's the same output, so it's free, basically. And WAF2, which is not compatible with gzip. It's a completely new algorithm, and it compresses much, much better. It's like 30% improvement over WAF, which is major. So the browser support is actually pretty decent for web fonts. Of course, life isn't as simple because every browser supports a different format. Let's take a look at EOT It's not supported by anything but Internet Explorer. But that's okay because it's a Microsoft format. Only IE8 supports EOT exclusively, and nothing else. So if you need to support IE8, then you should use EOT. Who here supports IE8 still? Only one person? Two? Wow, three, four, okay. It's not too bad. Yeah, if you don't need to support it anymore, then just you can forget about EOT as well, because why would you serve it? WAF2 is fairly new, and browser support for that isn't very good yet. It's coming, though. I heard the IE team is working on it. Firefox has it in nightly build, and I guess Safari will get it in a year or two as well, which is how Safari works, apparently. So what I usually recommend for, instead of the mess you saw before, is to use this. You give it a WAF2 file and WAF for everything else. And this covers pretty much every modern browser. If you need to support like older Android devices or iOS devices, you can add an OTF file or a TTF file. And this really gives you IE9 plus, it gives you Android 2.3 plus, iOS 4.3.2, and it's still simple and clean, and you can forget about EOT files if you're not one of those four people. And you can forget about SVG altogether. So what you sometimes see in web fonts are these other properties. You're probably familiar with font style, font weight, font stretch, font variant, font feature settings, and Unicode range from outside of font face. But you can also use them inside, which isn't that common. Font style, font weight, and font stretch are used to label a web font, so you can categorize it, basically. Font variant and font feature settings are used to set the default value for that web font. So if you want your web font to always be in small caps, for example, you can set font variant small caps. Same for font feature settings. If you want to enable or disable a specific open type feature for the web font, then you always have it enabled or disabled. Unicode range isn't that well supported, but you can use it to tell the browser which characters are included in the font. So it will smartly download them. So if a page doesn't include the characters that are in that font, it won't download it, which is a nice optimization. So basic browser support is pretty good. Font style, font weight are supported by everything. Font stretch, unfortunately not, which means that if you look at all the different categorization possibilities for web fonts, you have, I think it's 243 in total if you include font stretch, font weight, and font style. You have 243 possible combinations. But because font style isn't working in most browsers, you can only use 27, which kind of limits the number of ways you can categorize your fonts, which is a real shame. Font variant is a sad story. If you use it, it doesn't work at all inside font face. And in fact, in Chrome and I think Safari as well, and Opera now as well, if you use it, your web font won't even render, so don't use it. But it's a standard. It should be implemented at some point. Font feature settings, it's a similar story. Only Firefox supports it. So yeah, you can forget about it as well. It's not really a big problem, because you can still set those properties on the elements that you're using that web font on. So you're OK with that. I think the bigger problem is the lack of Unicode range support. It's a nice optimization that the browser can look at your page and say, well, I don't need this web font, so I'm not going to download it. But yeah, doesn't work, so too bad. So I want to move on and talk a bit about how browsers load web fonts. So when you look at a font stack in CSS, this is without web fonts, by the way. You can see that this is called the fallback fonts, which is kind of the font that you get when the font that you want isn't there. If it falls away, all the way back to sans serif, you get a platform-specific font. So it could be anything, really. For example, on Android, there are only three fonts installed on the system, and you just get one of those. So that's why it's always very important to define this fallback stack yourself. Now, that doesn't really change when you add web fonts into the mix. The only thing that changes is that the browser looks in the font face decorations before it looks on the file system. So if there's a match there, then it will use that font first, and then make a network request and load the font. So if you don't use the font, like you have declared a font face decoration, like Marco said, I don't know where he went, but he said it this morning as well. If you don't use it, it won't be loaded by the browser, which is a very nice optimization. So if you have, say you're designing a website and on you use media queries, and on certain media queries you don't want your fonts to load, then you can still put them in your CSS. And if you don't use them in that media query, then they won't be loaded. The downside to that is that browsers need to have both the HTML and the CSS available before it starts loading fonts. And that's a big problem, because if you look here, this is a simple HTML page with a single CSS file, and it takes like 500 milliseconds before it's loaded, which it's okay. But only at that point does it know that it needs fonts, and it will start downloading those fonts. And that means it adds a lot of extra time on top of your website. And this is why people complain about web font performance. It's because of this optimization that was put into CSS early, and now it's kind of hurting us again. There are ways around it, but we'll get to that in a second. So to recap, there are three basic steps when it comes to loading fonts, and this applies to both locally installed fonts and to web fonts. And it's actually the only slide where I have bullet points, because I don't like bullet points. They're not even actually bullet points, they're points, I guess. So the first one is the case where the font family is not recognized and the fallback font is applied. And if that's not available, then it goes to the next fallback font, et cetera, until it hits the generic font family name, or it picks a last resort font. The second step is the font family name is recognized, but the font isn't available yet. And this is what usually applies to web fonts. So the browser will start downloading it and apply it when it has finished downloading. And the third is the best case. The font family name is recognized, and the font is there, and it loads it immediately and applies it immediately. And this can happen for web fonts as well. I mean, it could be a web font that's in the cache, or it could be on a very, very quick connection. So the problem here is with the second step, and that is because there is a delay between the moment the browser recognizes that it needs a font and that it gets the font, and that's because of the network. So it takes a while to download fonts over a network. And this could be anything. I mean, if you're sitting in a train and you go into a tunnel, and at that exact moment the browser decides to start downloading web fonts, then you will never get your page or your web fonts. So browsers deal with that in two different ways, and let's for the moment pretend this is a web browser. So you type in a website, just example.com, and it starts loading. And the browser has loaded the HTML at this point, and it displays it right away without in the fallback font. And it's actually still loading, as you can see. And at some point later, the fonts pop in, and the page is loaded. And this is what we call the flash of unstyled text. And it means while the page is loading and while the web fonts are loading, it will still render the content in the fallback font. Now, there are some browsers who didn't really like that, because it flashes and it re-renders and it's not like perfect right away. So they came up with a different solution. And again, I'm going to start from scratch here to illustrate. You type in the web address, and you wait, and you wait some more, and then, ta-da, you get the final rendering with the web fonts. And this is what we call the flash of invisible text, and that means that the browser knows there's text and it could render it, but it decides not to render it until it has the web fonts needed to render it correctly the first time. And most browsers actually have a timeout to prevent the text from being invisible for too long. So if if the font takes longer to load than say 3 seconds, it will still render it in the fallback font, and then after it loads, it will re-render it. So you get a flash of invisible text, and then you get a flash of unstyled text, and then you get what you wanted, which I think is even worse. But that's the way browsers decide to do it. So I just did like a little overview slide here, with so you can see it graphically, the difference. So browsers are a bit divided on this. The IEs all do the flash of unstyled text, and the other browsers do the flash of invisible text. And Chrome, Firefox, and Opera actually have a timeout. So if your web fonts don't load within that time, you get the fallback font. Safari is actually an interesting case because it waits forever. So if you're stuck in a tunnel, you're just going to be staring at a white page of text for, well, until you get out of the tunnel, I guess. Yeah, this is what I said. So one way to deal with that is to use the Typekit and Google Web Font Loader, which is one of the things that I work on. That's a JavaScript library that loads web fonts for you. And it's free, you can use it. You just include it in your HTML page. And it gives you something called font events, so it will tell you when a web font has loaded, so you can style against it. So for example, here I loaded a couple of fonts, and I didn't show that part because it's just configuration. And you get two events called font active, and that means that your font has loaded, and active, which means that all fonts have loaded. And you can use this to also add classes to your HTML. So it adds a WF loading class to your HTML, and you can use that to style against that. So for example, if you want to simulate the flash of unstyled text on all browsers, which I think is the preferred way because people come to your website to see your content, not to see a white page, and not to see a pretty font. And that may be a bit controversial, but I really believe that content should come first. You can simulate that by just setting a default font while your page is loading. So your page will always render in sans serif or whatever web safe font that you choose. And then when the web font loader has detected that your font is active, you add it to your CSS stack for your page, and it will re-render it right away in your preferred font. And you still get a flash, but at least your content will be visible for the people in that tunnel. Now the W3C thought that was such a good idea that they actually standardized the web font loader into something called the CSS font loading API. And it's a JavaScript API that you can use to load fonts, and you also get font events, and you can manipulate also other fonts that are available on the page. And this is really nice because it's native support, so it's much faster than the web font loader, because the web font loader does all sorts of dirty tricks to find out when a web font has loaded, and this doesn't need to do that. So browser support for that isn't that good. IE8 and till IE11 don't support it. I again heard that they're working on it, so maybe soon. Firefox and Safari don't have it either, but Firefox has it in a nightly build, so that's going to be a couple months from now, and it's going to land. And Chrome and Opera have it already, so that's pretty great. So if you want to read more about the CSS font loading specification, you can go there. I also wrote a polyfill, so you can use the same API in IE9 Plus and Firefox, Safari, and any browser that doesn't have native. And it basically uses the same technique as the web font loader internally, but it has the same API as the native API. So I want to move to OpenType features, which is one of my favorite subjects. And for those of you who saw the call for the petition, if you're really looking for the OpenType menu, it's really not that hard to find in Illustrator, in InDesign. You just have to go here, and it's over here. OpenType features. I assume most of you are familiar with OpenType features. Who isn't? Just one person. Sorry. These are OpenType features. It's basically optional features in a font that you can enable or disable, and some of them are required for displaying fonts. I'm not going to go through all of them. There are about 140 of them, so that's quite a lot. So this is how CSS would like you to use OpenType features. They've extended the font variant property to include keywords for ligatures for small caps. And you can also prefix these things with a no if you don't want them. So for example, I don't want ligatures here, so I say no common ligatures. Now, unfortunately, there's no browser that supports that syntax, although it has been specified since, I don't know, 3 years ago or something like that. So what you can use is the lower level syntax, which uses the OpenType feature tags that are in each font, or sometimes they are. And you can turn on individual features or turn them off. Now, browser support for that is it's pretty good. Again, IE8, IE9, it's pretty much non-existent. Other browsers are doing pretty well, except Safari, which I kind of put in the sort of category, which means that it does support OpenType features, but it ignores any value that you give it. So you can say, I want small caps, but it says, no. And instead, it has decided that discretionary ligatures and ligatures and contextual alternates are always enabled by default because, well, we're Safari and we can do that sort of thing. So I'm going to come back to OpenType features later. So another OpenType feature is kerning. I assume everybody knows what kerning is. And again, the CSS specification has a property to enable kerning, which is called font-kerning. It's very original. You can set it to auto, to always kern, normal to only kern auto is like you tell the browser to do whatever the browser wants to do. So if it wants to use kerning, then sure. If it doesn't want to do that, then it won't use it. If you set it to normal, then it will always try to apply it, assuming kerning is available in the font. And you can set it to none if you want to completely disable it. Now, I thought this was the most interesting thing. Nobody supports it except Safari. I don't know why, because Safari already enables kerning by default, so you can only turn it off. And I'm not sure why you want to do that. But in the other browsers, you need to explicitly enable it using font feature settings, kern, and just set it to on, and then we'll enable it, assuming your font has kerning data. If you want to be future-proof, you can add font kerning normal, which doesn't do anything in current browsers, but maybe in the future it will. I also see a lot of people using the text rendering optimized legibility property. There are so many bugs with that, so I really recommend not using that anymore. There's also a weird box with web fonts and optimized legibility, so don't go there. Like I said before, browser support for that is pretty good. IE8, IE9, again, no. Safari doesn't support font feature settings, but it does support kerning, and it's already enabled, so you're good there. That's pretty much kerning. So I talked a little bit about the kerning is the spacing between characters or glyphs. So I want to move on to talk about the spacing between words, which is where hyphenation and justification comes in. You're probably familiar with the text align property. I guess everybody has used that. You can set to right, center, and justify. And this really works in every browser, luckily. So the problem with that is that when you decrease the column size, you decrease the measure, it starts doing funny things. You can see that here where it inserted a really large gap between the words and it starts creating rivers. And they're really obvious when you highlight them, which is one of my favorite pastimes. And if you add them all up, it really adds a lot of white space to your paragraph, and it really hurts readability. Your eye has to jump over all these, I'm sure you'll heard the talk before me. Your eye has to jump over all this white space, and it makes it really hard to read. I think also it affects your design, actually, because it changes the typographic color of your text. So if you have a badly justified column, it ruins the color of your, like you can see here. it ruins the color of your text. So you can get better justification by using a different justification algorithm. But browsers don't do that, unfortunately. What browsers do is they use something called the greedy algorithm, which is very simple. It tries to fit as many words on a line, and when it doesn't fit anymore, it moves the word to the next line and then continues. And then what it does is it stretches the space, word spacing in the line to align with the right or the left edge, depending on how you justify. And then it does the same thing again with the next line. And that works pretty well until about now, when it has to, the word beautiful doesn't fit anymore because it's too long. And the only solution is to move it to the next line and stretch the word spacing to a really large value, which this is the reason you get these large rivers in your text. And there's actually an alternative algorithm, which is the one that's used by Tech and InDesign. And instead of looking at a single line, it looks at line breaking opportunities over the whole paragraph. So for example, if you have the same text, then the first option would be to do the same thing. But another option would be to kind of shrink the word spacing in the first line and then fit it in and then move to the next line. And you can see that the left option comes into the same trouble as before, but the right option actually comes out pretty nice in the end. And you can see there's actually a more optimal justification. Now, like I said before, unfortunately, there's no browser that implements that. So I tried to implement it in JavaScript, and that worked, but it was really slow. You're just out of luck. And browsers don't want to change it because they think it's too slow. So the best way to fix that is to enable a hyphenation, which introduces more possible breakpoints. And you can see here I've enabled hyphenation, and you can already see that it's much better if you look at the typographic color. It's still a little bit off somewhere, but it's a lot better, especially when you compare it to before and after. If you have hyphenation, then please, or if you want to use hyphenation, if you use justification, then always enable hyphenation. So how to do that is you define a language on your HTML element and you set hyphens to auto. Support is pretty good, IE8, IE9, nothing. And Chrome and Opera get a sort of again, because they support the property, but they don't have any hyphenation dictionary, so you don't get any hyphenation. I just found out a couple of days ago that in the latest version of Chrome, they took out the hyphens property altogether because, well, what do people want with hyphenation? I don't know. So unfortunately, if you need to use hyphenation, you need to do it either server-side or you need to use a client-side JavaScript library, and I happen to have written one that you can use. It's pretty fast, and you just apply it to the elements that you want, and it works. So hyphenation solves bad justification, but it also introduces a couple new problems. So here you have like consecutive lines with hyphenations, which is kind of considered ugly. And there's a new CSS property for that, which limits the lines that can end with hyphenation, and you can set it to whatever you want. Also, hyphenation of last words, there's a property for that. You can enable it, disable it, or tell it not to do that if it can. And you can also configure where in a word it considers the possible breakpoints. So you can set hyphenate limit characters, and the default is to break everywhere. And if you set the first value, it will only consider like the word length that is more than the number of characters you give it. And the second value is the first breaking opportunity after that number of characters is ignored. So, and the same for the last one. So you can exclude kind of the hyphenation points that you don't want by configuring this. It also solves a problem that I'm not sure that we have, which is like the problem of having all these hyphens. And you can set your own hyphenation character And by default, it's the hyphen, of course, but you can also set it to a star if you really wanted to. I guess you could use it for languages that have a different hyphenation character, but on the other hand, you can also argue that those languages can just use a font that has the correct character for hyphenation. So support for hyphenation is really interesting. IE8, IE9, forget about it. Then IE10 and IE11 support pretty much everything except hyphenate character. And the other browsers do kind of the opposite, and that they don't support any of the others except hyphenate character. So so that's basically a quick overview of web type. And I think somebody said this, web design is 95% typography. And I was wondering, is that really true? Like, if you look at all the CSS properties, and these are all the CSS properties, and you highlight the ones that are related to typography, and it's actually only 18.6%, which is really disappointing, I think. And I think this is really something we should invest in as type designers, as type lovers, as web developers. We should promote and support the development of new typographic features in browsers. And we should really push this. You should go file bug reports. We should write articles. You should talk to browser vendors. I mean, let's fix this. I mean, this is ridiculous. We need better browser support for web fonts. It's horrible. Justification is broken. Hyphenation is broken. We don't have balanced text. We don't have drop caps. Open type features don't work. Well, what else do you have? Color fonts are sort of coming. Text rendering is whatever the operating system gives you. We need to be able to control that. Font loading it's coming. Kerning is getting there. Lettering, character alignment it's been specified since CSS version 1. You can align things on a character. No browser implements it. I don't know why. Widows, orphans, math layout is a joke. I mean, you can't do math on the web. It's ridiculous. So I think one of the ways to improve this is to keep track of what's supported and what's not in web browsers. And that's, I guess, Oliver launched it for me. so that's why I'm launching this new initiative, which is called the State of Web Type, which is like a can I use for web typography. It will contain browser support data for any web type related feature and explanations on how to use them as well. And I've already included all the data that I've shown today. And if there's like one more minute, can I do a little demo? Or yeah, would that be okay? Oh yeah, this is a wonderful test font for open type features. Please don't look at the design. That's why it's called beta. I focused on getting the data and the functionality working. But for example, if you're looking for information on font stuff, you can see all the browser support and like any exceptions to that. For example, font family in Internet Explorer. There's a little footnote there that says Internet Explorer limits the length of font family to 32 characters, which is a surprise to many people. And you can also say, I'm interested in open type features. And these are all the features that we tested browser support for. And you can look up each individual browser and each individual feature. For example, if you look at ligatures, for example, standard ligatures here, you can see that there's several bugs in Chrome, for example, where if your ligatures contain a space, then they won't render them because, well, I don't know actually why, but I think it's fixed. Yeah, it's fixed now. So so that's the sort of data that it will contain. And I'm going to look at make prettier soon. And I hope to do that sometime next week or the week thereafter, if I have time. Thank you. If you have any questions about web type, please contact me on Twitter or ask them now, I guess. So thank you.